privilege, God, of being able to come together and lift up our hands to you, to lift up our hearts to you, to lift up our voices to you, to honor you, to worship you. We do give you honor, we give you glory, and we give you all the praise. Glory, honor, and power is yours.
Yes,
we thank you, Heavenly Father. Thank you for all the things that you're doing for us on a day-to-day basis. You load us daily with benefits.
Yes.
Thank you for your benefits.
Thank you, Lord.
Father, we just pray right now, God, for your divine intervention, Lord, in all the affairs of our nation, God. As
yes,
you told us
God.
To pray for those that are in authority.
Yes.
We pray that you do only what you want to do, God. Father, we thank you, Lord, that you take up, you set up one and you take down another. So we give all of these political things over to you,
yes,
and we ask your help in it, God. And Father, we thank you, Lord. And God, we just thank you for this worship hour.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you for this time that we come together as many local bodies all over the earth is coming together,
yes,
at an 11 o'clock hour, God. And the focal point is you.
Yes.
And Father, we thank you, Lord. We thank you that we got a mind to want to come to church.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus, to lift up our hands, to worship you and to adore you. Thank you for changed lives. Oh, bless you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for a mind that want to be sold out to you, Lord. Thank you for salvation. Thank you for salvation. Thank you for salvation. And Father, we just give you praise today. And Lord, we thank you for utterance today. We pray for utterance that you would speak forth those things that are needful for your people. Holy Spirit, take charge and do what only you can do. Use this vessel as I decrease, you increase. We thank you for revelation knowledge. And we ask it in Jesus' name. And all the saints said,
amen.
Amen. Praise God. God is good. Amen. Thank you. Praise team. I hope you're blessed. Amen. I know you are. If you are, I want you to give God a shout of praise. As I alluded to Wednesday night, in a couple of weeks, we're going to be doing some fasting and praying. Amen. And I want to gear you up for that, and that's going to be my task for a couple of weeks, or it's sort of to just get to the point where we can get on track with it. Amen. And start to take our authority in God. Amen. And I often say, because the enemy can be shifted. Amen. I don't care what you got going on, the enemy can be moved. Amen. Amen. Whatever your hour of despair is, God can bring you out of it. Amen. And you have that power, you have that authority to take authority over the enemy and get what's been stolen from you back. Amen. In Ephesians chapter 3, before I get into my lesson this morning, Ephesians 3, Ephesians chapter 3, favorite chapter of mine, verse 7 says, whereof I was made a minister according to the gift of grace of God given unto me by the effectual working of his power. Amen. Amen. Verse 8 says, unto me who am less than the least of all saints is this grace given, that I should preach among the Gentile the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world hath been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ. Verse 10, to the intent that now unto the principalities and powers in heavenly places might be known by the what, somebody? I want everybody to say church.
Church.
By the church, the manifold wisdom of God, or the multifaceted ministry of wisdom of God. Amen. The church has this authority. All right. I want everybody to say the church has it. Praise God.
Church.
Come on, open your mouth and say it a little bit louder. Say the church. It's her.
Church.
Say I have it. Praise God. Okay. Notice it says that unto principalities and powers. Now, this is not angels in the third heaven. Amen. This is demonic activity in the second heaven, if you will. The Bible says that Satan is the prince and power of what? Of the air. Amen. So this is not the third heaven where Paul was translated up into. It's not talking about the third heaven where God resides, if you will. Of course, we know God is everywhere. But this is not the third heaven, because around the throne of God, there's nothing to be taught or bound. All right? So this is the second heaven. This is where demonic activities are going. And that's what you're experiencing in America today, is the manifestation of what's going on in the second heaven. Okay, the warfare in our political scheme is a direct result of what the principalities are doing in the heavens. Can I get an amen right there? Now, isn't it funny? The church ought to know that. The church ought to know that, but the church is in the midst of a battle with flesh just like the politicians are. The church ought to know that this is just manifestations of what some things that are occurring in the heavens. A lot of times you got things going on in your home. Talk to me. And all it is just a manifestation of your atmosphere. It's a manifestation of the heavenlies, something you hadn't dealt with in the heavenlies, and it's manifesting in your kids. I can't get no help up in here. I said it manifests in your kid. And until you get enough tenacity about yourself to take authority over the thing and shift the enemy, it'll keep on happening. Do I have anybody in here with a backbone this morning? It'll keep on happening. So the church is scattered in America. We're divided in America by race, by creed, by religious tactics, and all kind of other stuff. We're divided. And then we wonder why, and then we want to get up and fight about certain things. Just let me say here. See, the world loves its own. Can I talk to you? Look at somebody and say, the world loves its own, praise God. Now, the world don't like the church coming in and telling them that they're wrong. All right, and to a large part, we've been wrong on how we approach evangelism. Amen, because our job is not to go and criticize everybody and point the finger to everybody. The church ought to have love in it. Reach out and touch your name and say, church ought to have love, praise God. Because if you just look back just a little bit and see where you come from, if God had grace and mercy on you, then you ought to have grace and mercy on people that's out there doing whatever they're doing. If they're homonging and whatever, praise the homoing, it don't matter. So see, the church got this pointing finger mentality when what she needs to do, she's got a powerful thing. It's called love and authority. All right? They don't need to hear your dogma about them going to hell. Okay, we preach a Jesus that we don't exemplify, because Jesus hung out with everybody. I don't know, man. Jesus dealt with everybody. I ain't scared of nobody. How about y'all? I don't feel like nothing going to rub off on me, and then I'm going to get possessed with demons. I talk with anybody and everybody about anything they want to talk about, as long as they don't get vulgar. And I don't lose my religion just because I talk to a sinner. I ain't preaching to everybody up in here. And God hasn't given us a spirit of fear. All right? And the Bible calls us salt and light. We're the light of the world. We're the salt of the earth. Amen? So if we're going to do what needs to be done, it's funny, the church don't even know what's happening. The reason why the church don't know what happened, because you know what I'm getting ready to get into right now, is this thing about prayer. He said, my house shall be called a house of prayer. Now, I'm telling you, the church has that kind of authority. Whatever is lacking is in your prayer life. Amen. And when we have a need among us, praise God, we can pray that thing down. Say amen, somebody. You got so much power in you that I know some of y'all don't think you come on. If one of us gets sick, if we were to really get on one accord and pray, we could get the person healed. Our problem is not that we don't have the authority. Our problem is disunity. Now, I'm preaching Ben, you responded. Amen. Praise God. So when everybody start to connect the way they need to connect, there would be no lack. The Bible said there was not any lack among them. The early church. That's my pattern. How about you? I want End Time Harvest Church to be to a point, praise God, ain't no lack in the house. I want everybody, praise God, living where they want to live, driving what they want to. Come on here. Open your mouth this morning. Just agree with the man of God. I want you living where you need to live. I want you driving what you need to drive. I want you wearing what you need to wear, because God is a prosperity God. God brought him out of the wilderness, praise God, and gave him silver and gold and cattle. Gave him everything they need, and their shoes didn't even wear out. And the Bible said there wasn't even a fever among them. Come on. He's no respected person. If he did it for the children of Israel under an old covenant, and you got better blood than that of Abel. Come on, you got better promises. Surely he'll do it for somebody that gets on fire for him.
Glory to God. And just come on out and say, well, I'm going to get back to what the Bible says, Faith. They done made church out of everything, but we're going to pray. Amen. Reach out and touch somebody and say, we're going to pray, praise God. And not only are we going to pray, we're going to pray that something happen. Amen. We're going to pray that something break. Oh, Shatana Mahata Bakashalaba. Hallelujah. I said, we're going to pray that something break. We're going to pray that every principality that's hovering over every family is broken. We're going to pray that everybody, ain't nobody going to be dealing with drugs and. Come on, we ain't messing with the person. We're going after the principality. We're going to teach them that they don't run nothing. If you are part of this church, there is no reason for your kids to be hooked on dope. Come on, if you profess to have all the power you have, let's get on in this thing and get on down to nitty-gritty business. Come on, let's get some neology going on. Let's do what Jesus taught us to do. Let's pray till something break loose. All of my kids are saved, five baptized, tongue-talking, full of the Holy Ghost. Come on, walking in the precepts of God, walking in the principles, walking in the knowledge of God. I declare it and I decree it. I'm a daysman. I'm standing in the gap. Say amen, somebody. They may have a liquor bottle in their hand right now, but I pray in Jesus' name, praise God, that they are healed from every disease. They are healed from everything that hinders them, praise God. Because there's a Daniel in the family. If I got something in here, won't you holler and say amen real loud? And I ain't going to give up. I don't like giving up folk, praise God. I'm not going to give up. I'm pressing my way until I see a change. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Look at somebody and say, we're going to teach them, praise God. Hallelujah. Praise God. The church has that power. Amen. Very familiar, Matthew 16. This is the first time the church is mentioned by Jesus. I've taught you that before, but let's go back and look at it. Matthew 16, are we there? Matthew 16, verse 17 says, and Jesus answered and said unto him, blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father, which is in heaven. And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build what? Okay, and what? Okay, and then he goes into something here in verse 19. He says, and I will give unto thee the keys to the kingdom of heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. And whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Again, I've taught you before, ain't nothing need to be bound and loosed at the throne of God. Amen. All right, so this heavenly thing, binding and loosing, is dealing with Satan again. Now, I want you to notice something here. I said that this is the first time the church is mentioned in the Bible. Are y'all here? Okay, everybody say, this is the very first time, praise God. The very first time the church is mentioned in the Bible, and look what it's dealing with. Satan pops up. All right? It's conflict. Look at my amen. All right? The first time it's mentioned in the Bible, is talking about Satan and the conflict that the church has with Satan. Okay, so we cannot placate that. We cannot water that down. And you better understand that it's not God's enemy, it's your enemy. You hear what I say? Okay, Satan is your enemy. He's no match for God. Matter of fact, he gave the earth to man. He's your enemy. He's after you. Are you here? How many hear what I'm saying right now? Let me go back. I have to review for some of the new people. God does not get up every day and box with Satan. Satan is a created being. God created Satan. Satan ain't never been a match for God. All Satan is a tool in God's hand. Are you here? But he's your enemy. Do you hear what I'm saying? I said, he's your enemy, and until you recognize that, you won't treat him as such. Satan is your enemy. He's out to get you. The very first time the church is mentioned, God is letting you know that there's a devil out here that don't want you to succeed and don't want you to have authority and don't want you to press into the things that I provided. So he says, what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you some keys to the kingdom. Come on, church, that whatsoever you bound on earth, then you won't deal in the heavenlies. Y'all ain't up in the house. That's why you need to be happy that you're sitting by a brother and sister this morning and say, thank God for my brothers and sisters in church. Praise God. Okay, because I was talking with a good friend of mine yesterday, and I was telling him, nobody gets to where they need to. Somebody got to help you. Amen. Say amen, somebody. I said, you're already messed up if you think you're a lone island out here by yourself. You need help from somebody. Say amen real loudly in here. Lord, I say you need help from somebody. If you're an isolated person and you like the idea of you being alone and you got all the answers and you don't want to socialize and you don't want to deal with people, you better come on in the church. Because iron sharpens iron. You need help. You can't get there. The enemy will isolate you by yourself and beat you to death out there. Okay, I don't know whether anybody know what I'm talking about. How many know what I'm talking about right here? You need help, praise God. Thank God you're in church with brothers and sisters that are housed in the Holy Ghost. Because they can help you get to where you need to go. Amen. That's why the Bible said they had all things in common. I'm going to work on this thing, man. Come on, hit your name and say they had all things in common. All right? There were not any big eyes and little U's and all this here kind of stuff. Everybody was cool with everybody. Say amen, somebody. Amen. Yeah, they had all things in common. Hit your name and say, that's what we're striving for, praise God. I'm preaching to you every week. I just read a verse that Paul says he's the least among all saints, the great apostle Paul. I'm preaching to you every week, praise God, for your identity. Amen. So you understand when you get your identity right, you'll start to treat your fellow man right. Amen. The reason we mistreat folks is because we don't know who we are. Amen. And what we got going on in America is an identity crisis. Look how y'all looking, man. I said, what we have going on in America is an identity crisis. All right? If you don't know what bathroom to go to, come on here. You got an identity crisis going on. Say amen, somebody. If you're trying to figure out whether you need you a man and whether you want to wear women underwear, you got an identity crisis going on. Okay, you got an identity crisis going on if you're a woman and then you liking a woman. Okay, you got an identity crisis going on if you're a man. So you come to church and we're going to identify you. I'm going to tell you, I'm not going to placate it. I'm going to spit it out. I'm going to tell you, if you're a man, if you got a penis, you're a man. Wake up and say amen like you're alive up in here. And if you got a vagina, you're a woman. If you have a period. Say amen, somebody. You got ovaries. I don't care how much men cologne you put on. I don't care how many boy shorts you wear. I don't care how short you cut your hair. Hey, reach out and touch somebody and say, get the ID right, man. Get the ID right. Who are you, praise? That's what I want to ask right now, praise. Who are you, praise God? Anybody feel like asking that question sometime? All right. Come on, just shout it out real loud. Who are you, praise God? Made me go back to the early 70s. The who? I don't know. Y'all don't know about them rock bands and everything. So who? Who are you? Who? I really want to know. I want to ask the question. Do you know who you are? Look here. Just what I'm saying right now will help you out. Because if you're a woman, you have a menstrual cycle. Come on. You have ovaries. Okay. And then if you're lacking other women, then the church need to get you tuned up. How y'all looking, man? Okay? The church need to get you tuned up and reconstruct your values. All right? How you going to do that, Pastor Womack? You got some kind of a psychological approach? No, I got the Word of God. That's above everything. Y'all ain't up in the house. The Word of God will change you. Who? Y'all not listening to me right now. I said the Word of God is not by the washing of the water, by the Word. If you sit under the right Word, whatever got you bound will let you go. Somebody holler real loud in here. You hear what I say? I say, whatever got you bound. and I'm a witness. Say amen, somebody. That's why some of y'all don't like me, because I get right in your bedroom, because I've been there and I've done that. Say amen, somebody. Hallelujah. You can't bluff me out. If I got over cocaine, you can get over it. What? Wave at me, praise God. If I got over sex, you can get over it. Come on, if I got over marijuana, you can get over it. Come on, if I got over the blunts, you can get over it. Come on, if I got over the chronic, you can get over it. If I got over the pills, you can get over it. If I got over the LSD, you can get over it. If I got over the beer, you can get over it. If I got over the wine, you can get over it. If I got over the liquor, you can get over it. Ain't no shame in my game. I say, ain't no shame in my game. I want to say he brought me out. And he brought me out because can't nobody. You better go on and give him a shout of praise right now. Because if you can pray, hey! Somebody say, I know what he's talking about. I know. I got a testimony too. I know what he's talking about. I don't know the last time I threw up. Y'all ain't up in the camp. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. I can see myself on the balcony of my apartment smoking my last joint. Y'all ain't talking. Come on here. And then, because when I was smoking it, I was getting phobias and stuff. See, I'm talking to somebody right now. That's why the Holy Ghost is pulling me in there. You crazy. You still smoking the stuff, and you still got phobias and paranoid and all kind of stuff. Stop smoking the crap. Yeah. You can't master nothing like, come on. I told God, I said, God, you know, I ain't smoking no more dope. Y'all ain't up in the, come on, with the joint in my hand. Y'all don't want to talk, man. It ain't good to get high by yourself, no how. That's why I don't care nothing about you, because I know you're coming here with your church face on, but I got your number. I know where you come from, because I'm cut out of the same heat. Say amen, somebody. Been there, done that. I know how you feel when them women on your mind. My mind on my money on my mind. And yeah, I know all about that gin and juice. Look how y'all looking, man. Naughty head. Yeah, they come in here looking at me like Pastor Womack. You don't know nothing about me, man. You don't know nothing about, you don't know me. I keep on trying to tell you. Tangeray. Lord have mercy. Hallelujah. Hey, but look at me now. Look at me, look at me, look at me. Ain't nothing wrong with my liver. Ain't nothing wrong with my heart. God will reverse the curse out your life. Should have been dead long time ago, but I keep on living anyhow. Hallelujah! Glory, 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 glory. I just want to say he brought me out, praise God. I say he brought me out, praise God. I say he brought me out, praise God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. That's why I'm the least among saints. I've been through all that hell. Come on, I had to sidestep some stuff. Y'all ain't talking. I had to sidestep women. Think what you want to think. I don't care. You calculate it the way you want. I don't say I'm just spitting it out. I had to sidestep women. Come on here, because some of us, you know, we ain't had no problem with women. We were just trying to get out, because they were running behind us. Look how you look at me. Look at it. Some of y'all ain't saying amen because they still. You just ain't told your wife or whatever, praise God. I had to sidestep some stuff, and then every time the devil sees you, it's not going to be something that's not appealing to you. They will come with degrees and money with their own bank account. Y'all don't want to talk. Look how you look at me. Thank you. So all you got to do is just, do what you do. Say amen, somebody.
Amen.
But God.
But God.
Hit your name and say, but God, praise God.
God.
Come on, go ahead on, say amen. My wife, all right, so y'all go ahead on, just come on, just perk up and say amen like I'm preaching the gospel.
Amen.
I'm telling you. You blessed to be in church because church can get some stuff broken off of you. Okay, this is the first time it's mentioned, and Jesus inserts right in there, right off the bat, that the church is in conflict. We are not on vacation. I don't care what Joel says. Say amen, somebody. We are not on vacation, praise. We got to guard ourselves. Say it, because the enemy is always waiting on a church member to mess up. Y'all ain't up in the house. Hey, come on here. We ain't sitting back hoping that he don't mess with us. I'm telling you, what we doing in time harvest, we going into his camp. We're not on the defensive, we're on the offensive. Anytime we feel like we're being attacked, we're going to attack him. ISIS better not mess with me. Y'all hear me? All right. See, if you get that mindset, you can keep the enemy out your house. All right. I told you once before, never relax just because you had a good time in church. That is not an indication that you need to relax and go on vacation. That's where you need to pique your interest, pique your game, and turn it up, because the enemy has come. Whatever you got in church that Sunday, whatever you got in church that Wednesday, the thief comes to steal, kill, and to destroy. So you get back up on the offenses and get back in the game and keep winning and keep going from glory to glory. Somebody say, fight this thing, man. Fight it, praise God. I know you super spiritual and you in rest, but you can sit down there and rest, and the devil will creep right up in your camp and take your wife, take your husband, take your children. You better fight the good fight of faith. Come on, and when it's time for you to fast, don't hesitate. Just go on and do it, praise God. Amen, somebody. Everybody say conflict. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Doesn't matter how many battles I go in, I just want to win every one. Look, I ain't preaching to everybody. I'm going to say it again. I said, doesn't matter how many battles I go into, I just want to win. I want to be like David said, he's a battle axe in the time of a battle. Shelter in a time of storm. Hallelujah. You're the shield and a buckler. Thank you. We serve a military God. Y'all ain't up in the house. We serve a God that says, I dare to anything in those second heaven that's trying to mess with you. You put your sword on. You put your shield on. Put your breastplate on. Put your helmet on. Say amen, somebody. Put your belt on. And go into war, praise God. Don't you lay down and take the mess that the devil is doing. Do I have a witness up in here? Get up and pray. Hey! I feel something blowing in here. Pray. Get up and shake yourself and fight again. Wait a minute. What was I praying about last week? Now start back praying it over again. You're trying to trick me, praise God. But it's what I bind that's going to be bound. It's what I loose that's going to be loose. The church has the authority. Yeah, I'm with them, but you better get with them. Come on, because it's to the degree that you touch and agree with me that victory is coming to you. Are you here? Okay, Paul says, I hear there's schisms among you. contentions. Are you not yet babes? I know we pretty cool up in here for the most part. You understand? But he said, if you have contentions and divisions among you, you're nothing but a baby. You don't send babies to war. Are y'all here? When I was a child, I spoke as a child. When I was a child, I understood as a child. But when I become a man, I put away childish things. I'm a man now, and I understand that whatever comes my way. I told you the other week, praise God, when I was up in Indiana, God downloaded something to me. God said, look here, as long as you keep doing what the Bible says, as long as Yusa was with God, God was with him. Y'all don't hear me right now. And that's what the vision that God was showing me was. I was trying to explain it to you, but I couldn't. I don't know how to explain what I saw. But what it was stuff get contaminated when you get off. Okay, your thought life can be off. And then something starts to filter into your space. You understand what I'm saying? And it ain't good. All right, you're still saved. You're still, you know, you're still Holy Ghost filled, but you let something in the back door. And it starts to cloud everything else. Can you hear me? How many understand what I'm saying right there? Hallelujah. He told Yusuf, he said, as long as you're with me, and that's what David told Solomon. As long as you're with God, God will be with you. We done got deep, man, but that's cutting it right to the core right there. If you stay with God, God will stay with you. Whoa, 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 whoa. Do you hear me? Do you hear me? Everybody say, if you stay with God, he'll stay with you. Now, Yusuf made the mistake. He started to get up. The Bible says he built military machines way back in the day, man. Things that would catapult rocks at the enemy and, you know, bazookas and stuff. You're not, as you know, bazooka, but he had a mind of engineering, you see? And he built, the army was great under his reign. But he got up so high and mighty that he started to look at himself. And I'm going to get there in a second. All right? And when he did that, one day he decided he wanted to go in the temple like the priests were doing. All right? Just trust me. All right? And he went in and wanted to sacrifice like the priest. Wait a minute. Now, you're the king. Why would you want to be a priest if you're the king? Just be what you are. Now, he done got so big, now he's going into the temple where the priests go, and went in there, and the Bible said he struck him with leprosy. And he was a leper for the rest of his life. Are you there? As long as you're with God, God is with you. Come on, somebody help me say that. If you're with him, he's with you. It's simple. It's simple. Don't let nothing discourage you from walking with God. Amen? Wow. Man, I'm going to get you in trouble, man. I said nothing. Not even your wife. Okay, everybody got a good wife, say amen loudly. Help me out up in here. I said not even your wife, not even your husband. Are you here? Okay. Think not that I come to bring peace, but a sword. A man's enemy. Y'all don't like the Bible. Come on, shall be they of their own house. Say amen, somebody. Is somebody in here trying to figure out why my kids ain't acting right toward me? Yeah, it could be that you done got right and the devil pulling on them and you blocking. Okay, and what you need to do is take that cell phone. I told y'all we're going to get in trouble. Take the cell phone. If they threatening suicide, go on, do what you got to do. Say amen, somebody. Hallelujah. Praise God. They don't need all that stuff no how. I'm talking about following a Pokemon. How about follow the Holy Ghost? How about letting the Holy Ghost lead you somewhere? Come on. A whole generation, man, done lost their mind because somebody put some little circuit wires in a thing that you can hold in your wrist and bring information when you still don't know nothing. Say, you can't even fry an egg. Shout out loud and wake up everybody that ain't paying attention right now. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. You get work your way around a keyboard and work your way around a cell phone. Come on. And all that kind of stuff. But you don't know how to make your bed up. Come on here. You don't know how to clean a toilet. Get the brush and put the stuff in there. Y'all don't want to talk, man. I got the mic. I'm preaching. You don't like it? Go on home. Say amen, somebody. That's what I say, man. We got too many wimps in the pulpit. Don't want to tell nobody. That's my child. I love my child. You are brewing a monster. Take the cell phone. If they can't do what you want them to do, they don't need no cell phone. Because if they're disobedient to you, you don't know what they're doing on their phone. Hey, you're just going to have to pout and do whatever you want to do. Can I get a witness in the camp? Wow. Hallelujah. Wow. I knew I was going to get in trouble, man. Come on here. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And then the women have to be women enough, or woman enough, to understand that you need a man in your life. You need the brothers in your church in your life. If you don't have a father or a husband, then you need to get your kids in church and keep them in church. All right, and then they need to spend time with some of us. Say amen, somebody. Look how you look at man. Okay, if you got a little girl, you got a little boy, the little boy needs to spend time. And some of us, we're going to have to stop being so selfish and open our homes to folk. I mean, come on. What you got that you own? You don't own nothing. God, you're just a steward to what God gave you. If God can't use it, you don't need it. We're going to have to drop our guards and let folk in so they can see how you live, see how you talk, see how you walk. Can I get a witness up in the camp? And there again, they may not be. Come on, the little boy may not be where it needs to be. Ain't nothing going to rub off on your little boy. You help the mother train. Wow. They had all things in common. Church is supposed to be a community. Each one reach one. It's not you sitting out by yourself with your own little stuff. That's one reason why, you know, I want wealth. Now, Brenda got her hand up. I said, I want wealth. Not to heap it upon myself. I want to be so wealthy that I can, come on, can bless folk when I feel like, well, I want to bless them. And you got to hear my heart, man. You got to hear my heart. Okay. How many like to film on Wednesday night of the guys in Africa? All right. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hey, you got a good look at the compound and everything. Nice looking stuff, huh? Because God ain't giving us junk. In the future, he's not going to give us junk. The kingdom ain't junk. Are you here? Hallelujah. But those boys, that wasn't all the boys, that was just some of them. All those boys, the small ones, everybody. Man, look here, man. It ain't no task. Yeah, we send money over there every month. It ain't no task. It's love. They are family. Okay, if I lived in Africa, I would wish that I had a church in Georgia, come on here, that would help me. It ain't no task. Come on. And see, all that is seed, because there's more that God want to do like that. Yeah, I want wealth. Come on, hit your name and say, yeah, I want it, praise God. I want it, praise God. I want it, praise God. Certain things I want to do in Warner Robins. Say amen, somebody. Okay, you get the person off of crack, but you can't send them back out there into the crack community. They got to have an environment where they can grow up into Christ and be who God wants them to be. Okay, until somebody can get that stigma off their life, you are not a crackhead no more. Go ahead on and shout amen, somebody. Hey, you ain't no chicken head no more. You're a woman of God. You're a princess, praise God. You're a queen, praise God. That's the way the church should be thinking, praise God. Hit your name, so that's the way you ought to think, praise God. You come in one day, one way, but you leave out another way. Come on, somebody shout, the church has that kind of power, praise God. Transforming power. Hallelujah, praise God. Hallelujah. So the enemy comes, he knows there's conflict. conflict. The church. Ain't no such thing as a church on a cakewalk. There's conflict. We're binding. We're loosening. Are you here? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. So that means leadership has to be strong. Reach out and touch the name and say, you can't be following no weak folk, praise God. Okay, so go to priests, so go to people. As go to priests, so go to people. All right? If the pastor is a flirt, a homemonger, whatever he is, it's going to trickle down. There's a trickle-down effect. Are you here? Thank you. By the same token, if the pastor is striving to live holy, has one wife, doesn't have his eye on other women, say amen, somebody. Somebody say strong leadership, strong. There's a trickle-down effect where the enemy can't get into your family. Are you here? Leadership has to be strong. Are you here? Thank you, Jesus. Deacon Scott, you got to be strong. All right? As a leader in the church, you got to be strong. Somebody always looking at you. Look how you're looking, man. Somebody always looking at you, watching what you're doing. Waiting to accuse. When you think they're not looking, that's when they're looking. Don't let nobody catch you doing something that's not right out in the street somewhere. Get your reputation right. Say amen, somebody. Now you can't stop them from lying, but let it be a lie. Are y'all here? You can't stop them from talking, but just let them talk, and you keep your integrity. If that's happening, then the enemy, he cannot penetrate the church. Okay? That doesn't mean he won't try. Are y'all all right? Hey, look at your name and say, this is what we do, man. This is what we do. Hallelujah. Praise God. Deacon Stinson, this is what we do. We guard the church. We fight. We make sure that stuff ain't going wrong. Are you here? It's a spiritual stance. All right? We need strong folk in the church. All right, okay, Minister Talisha, let me get the women in here. This is somebody accused me of discriminating. All right, so we need strong women in the church that holds up a standard. Okay, Minister Roberts, amen. Hallelujah. We need strong women in the church that don't shake and tremble, do what they need to do, when they need to do it. Say amen, somebody. Some Dorcases, some Deborahs, Aquilas. Priscilla, come on, Philip's daughters that did prophesy. Amen. Say amen, somebody. Amen. And if that's going on, praise God, ain't nothing the devil can do. Amen. It don't mean that he won't try. Amen. But we got the tools. Amen. Touch somebody and say, we got what it takes, praise God. Tell them again, I'm up for the conflict, praise God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Look at Matthew 18. This is the second time the church is mentioned. And here's the other thing. Y'all all right? Here's the other thing. The church, okay, first one, each time the church is mentioned, it's dealing with conflict, really. They're dealing with conflict. But I'm going to stem this next one into discipline. All right? Everybody got Matthew 18? Hallelujah. All right? Yeah, because this is about if somebody in the church get off. All right? Let's see what it says here. Moreover, if our brother, verse 15, shall trespass against thee, go and tell him his fault between thee and him alone. That'll help somebody out. All right? Amen? Praise God. And if he will hear thee, thou hast gained. You have won your brother. But if he will not hear thee, take with thee one or two more, that out of the mouth of two or three witnesses every word may be established. Are you there? All right. So you get some elders in the church. You get some deacon and say, well, I went and I tried to get her to see this here. She didn't see it. So I'm coming to y'all. Y'all go with me. So let's talk together. Are you there? See, this is discipline. This is all about the church. Are y'all listening? And if he shall neglect to hear them, do what? Tell it to the church. Second time the church is mentioned. It's showing you your authority. It's showing you what kind of power you have. Are y'all paying attention right now? tell it to the church. Amen. But if you neglect to hear the church, what do you do? Okay, let him be unto thee as a heathen and as a publican. Okay, your church. Nowadays, folk don't like church discipline. All right, so when disciplinary actions take place, if a person don't receive the actions, the Bible says you should shun them. Look at my amen. Say amen, somebody. I know you tell folk do stuff wrong, and then you correct them, and then they leave the church hot. Say amen, somebody. Then the next time you see them in the street, they talking about how wrong we are. Okay, you shouldn't even be talking to them folk. You should shun them according to what the Bible says. See, they trying to make you feel like you wrong. Where the love is. I ain't getting no help up here. Where the love at? Okay, what kind of love was Jesus talking about in Matthew 8? I think that's love. Because what he's saying is a little leaven will leaven the whole lump. If you let that junk stay in the church, they're going to go and contaminate somebody else. Root of bitterness start to spread. And before you know it, everybody come to church looking at one another all cross out because somebody done spread something they should have. Discipline should be in the church. I know if you ain't been in a church, a real church, then you just let everything run wild and that's how stuff get off. And you got folk fornicating in the church. Come on, husband going with somebody else cross from the church. Everybody say, not up in here, praise God. No, no, no. Do you see it? Do you see it? Yeah, everybody in me don't like you because he wants somebody to lower their guards. You see? You lower them down, then he can creep in the church. Okay, how about this here first mention? How about Genesis chapter 2 or Genesis chapter 3? God created two people. Okay, let's read where we at on Matthew 15. Okay, what's the next verse say? Next verse, Matthew 18, yeah. Let's go there. Okay, and verily I say unto you that what you shall bind on, whatever you shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. You see, it's the same thing. Are you here? Yes. Praise God. This time he's dealing with discipline, you see, but it's still the church has the power. Are y'all getting this? Whatever you bound, see, that's why I'm giving you kudos for your prayer. Go right on up into the enemy camp, bind what you need to bind, loose what you need to be loose, stay apostolic, stay prophetic, stay powerful when you pray. Let the Holy Ghost lead you in your prayer. All right, okay. And you shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatsoever you shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. You see, same thing. Discipline, the church has the binding and loosing power also. Okay, next verse. Okay, again, I say unto you, if the two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that they shall ask, look how much power you got. It shall be done for them of my Father, which is in heaven. That's you, church. If you can get somebody to agree with you, next verse. For where two or three are gathered in together in my name, there am I in the midst. Okay, this is a misquoted verse. You know, they said where two or three are gathered in his name, where two or three gather in his name, I'm in the midst. All right, but it's gathered, E-D. Okay, it's not gather. Because any Tom, Dick, and Harry just can't gather and be the church. Gathered indicates that somebody has gathered them, namely the Holy Ghost. Oh, you're missing a good place to say amen right there. The Holy Ghost gathered them together. Now that's a church. Those two or three, they have power. So like the birthing of this church, James Kirkwood, Matt Maddox, Mary Maddox, Julia Womack, Melvin Womack. Wow, look at that. I just, out of all of these years, five, grace, gathered together in base housing and decided that we're gonna be a church. Are y'all here? And from heaven, the Holy Ghost signified and said, this man is going to be set ministry in the church. And the rest is history. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's not everybody gathered together. It's those that are gathered. You just can't go and start a storefront. Look how you're looking, man. And God has to gather together. And then if he gathers together, he will stamp it with a seal of approval that you can get everything I'm talking about this morning, the gates of hell. Hey, come on. If God instituted it, it cannot be stopped. He that has begun a good work in me shall perform it until the day I am persuaded that he's able to keep that I have committed unto him against that day. If God started it, can't nothing stop. Despise not the day of small beginning. It's not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord. I don't care how small your stuff look. If God started it, it'll blow up after a while. Are y'all here? Y'all to reach out. I feel comfort right now. How many feel it? Feel what I feel? I'm on safe ground because the Holy Ghost gathered somebody. Okay, if you don't believe it, how you got here? Come on, you got here because the Holy Ghost said, that's where I need to be. Riding down the road, come on, listen to 102 point something. Say amen, somebody. Hear that crazy man preaching on the radio. Say, who in the heck is that? Say amen, somebody. But that's the truth, though. Say amen, somebody. He wasn't messing around. Come on here, I'm going to go and find out where he at. That's the Holy Ghost gathering you. Hallelujah. You got that kind of authority. Ain't nothing the enemy can do. All right? All right? And it says that any two of you that agree, everybody agree, go back to that agree verse. Is that the verse before that, I believe? I say again, if two of you shall agree. The word agree is Symphonia. It means it's like a symphony. All right? It's like an orchestra that comes into unison. Okay? They all playing the same chord. And it's beautiful. Are you here? Okay? So he's saying anybody that comes into one accord, like an orchestra, and it starts to sound beautiful, you see, agreement. Then you're going to get what you're going for. Are y'all here? Hallelujah. Every time, man. Every time. Amen? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. So there's conflict and there's discipline in the church. Amen? So you got to get in love with discipline. All right? According to Hebrews chapter 12, it says that if you don't accept discipline, then you are illegitimate. You're a bastard. Are you here? Those that he loved, he chastens, the Bible says. Amen? So you got Satan coming against the church. And both times that they're mentioned, when Jesus first mentioned them, Satan is trying to mess with it. Amen? Praise God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. So we have to be on our P's and Q's. Amen? Praise God. Hallelujah. But Satan cannot overtake what God is doing. Amen. Yeah, that's a good place to clap. Thank you. I don't care how you know stuff be looking ragged in your house. Don't worry about it. God is in charge. Amen. Stay on guard and watch God do what he said. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise God. Now, I want you to look, praise God, at John chapter 14. St. John 14. This is critical. St. John 14 and verse 30 says, Hereafter I will not talk much with thee, for the prince of this world cometh and has nothing in me. Okay, look up here at me. Look up here at me. Look. This should be your goal. All right? This should be your goal. God, I want to live in such a way that the enemy don't have nothing in me. Zilch. Zero. Nothing. Are y'all here? Okay, if you don't set the goal, you can never go after it. I don't want to have nothing in me that the enemy can accuse me or tamper with. Wow. Are y'all all right now? Thank you, Jesus. I told you a verse I found the other day. Look at 2 Corinthians 8 and 12. 2 Corinthians 8 and 12. For if there be first a willing mind, it is accepted according to that a man has, and not according to that he has not. If you got a heart and you willing, then God says, I'm going to count it like you got it already. All right? So I'm already, God, see, at some point, Lord, in my life, I don't want the end of my thoughts, what I desire, everything about me, I want it to be so godly that the enemy can't find nothing in me. I ain't getting no help up in here. See, I set the goal. If I set that goal, then before I leave this earth, I'm going to get close to that goal. The wicked one comes, but he has nothing in me. God, I feel the Holy Ghost in here. Come on, not another boathouse car. I want to be more godly. I want to be more like Jesus, that when he comes, he can't find nothing in me. Are y'all here? Glory to God. Is that good to you? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I told you once before, I don't want to just stop sinning. I want to lose the whole desire for sin. I want God to return me back to innocence. You understand? I want him to get back to that point to where I'm just in his presence and that's all I need. I don't know. Sometimes I feel like an alien when I preach stuff like that, but that's my heart. They that do hunger and thirst after righteousness shall be filled. No, we're not there yet, but that's what we want. That's what we want. That's what we're going after. Glory to God. So be ye holy, for I, the Lord God, am holy. Come on, whatever them mean that the enemy is still messing with, I want that thing gone. Come on, shout amen in here. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And young folk, you don't open yourself up to stuff, then you don't have stuff, battles you don't need to fight, unnecessary battles. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. I want it all gone. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And I believe that's the task that God has on us. He said, Melvin, what I want you to do, I want you to build a church in Warner Robins, Georgia, a church that's striving after cleanness. Wake somebody up and shake them. Say, you hear what the preacher said up there, praise God. Holiness. Are you there? Ezekiel 28. I was talking about the first mention. Let me say that before you can go ahead and turn to Ezekiel 28. But the first mention is that Adam and Eve, God gathered them. Right? Okay, there you go. They gathered. And then what happens? Third chapter, here comes Satan. Do you see the pattern? Every time. Okay, the first book of the Bible, which is not Genesis, which is what, students? Job. Okay, the first book of the Bible opens up with God having a counter, a conversation, let's make it like that, with Satan about Job. Wait a minute, now this is the first book of the Bible, and it was important enough for him to mention that the devil is up pulling strings. Y'all don't hear me right now. All right? So if you don't believe that, you just walk through life like stuff just happening and everything is just coincidental. The very first book of the Bible, the first book that Moses wrote, Genesis, Satan comes in. The very first book of the Bible, Satan comes in. And you walking through life like you in charge. It is not within a man that walketh to direct his own steps. Jeremiah chapter 10. Say amen, somebody. You're being led by something. And so a lot of us, there's a puppeteer pulling string. And all you do, that's why you open yourself up, and young folk think older people don't know anything. We know exactly what we're talking about. Yeah. Say amen, somebody. Yeah. Well, see, they old, they not young, they don't feel. No, the devil is messing with your hormones because he want to ruin and defeat your life. You can do without a boy. You can do without a girl. You can do without a man. You can do without a woman. Don't let nobody derail you and defame you and get you out of your purpose, praise God. Somebody shout amen in here, praise God. Hallelujah. He's bombarding them with all kind of stuff. You can't even look at cartoon without you see the girl. She got a little small waist and a big butt and big bust. poisoning your kids at a young age, trying to get you to look at that female design. How am I doing up in the camp? You're the point. So you get all hooked up on sex and lust, and you 14, 15 years old, you may not even graduate high school. Say amen, somebody. So then you become just another stat, another statistic, another unwedded mother, come on, in the project that I got to pay for. Y'all don't want to open your mouth. Your tax money, come on, taking care of folk that ain't got no scruples about themselves. Your tax money taking care of feeding baby kids. Because ain't nobody taught them to close their legs. Y'all better say amen real loud. Don't you clam up on me now. Shout amen real loud in here. It's just the truth, and that's the problem. The truth will make you free. And then once you hear it, you continue in the truth. It is still wrong for you to be having sex outside of wedlock. It's still wrong for you to be having babies when the daddy ain't there to take care of. Stop it. Can I get a witness up in the camp? Hallelujah. I feel like preaching, so you might as well on the edge me on and get on in there with me. Say amen, somebody. Hallelujah. I said it's still wrong, praise God. God still has a design, and his design is for two men, a woman and a man to be holy. Say amen, somebody. And then to produce holy offspring. Whoa. You going to go there, Pastor? I'm like, yeah, I'm going there. Come on, holy offspring. And God is so good, he'll give you your stuff back. If you're messed up, praise God, and you got some baby kids. Say amen, somebody. God will give you, come on, you get yourself clean, get yourself sanctified, and God will give you a clean, sanctified husband that will come and take the stigma off your life and raise those kids like they're his own. I ain't got time to mess around with y'all. Come on here, and you stop talking about this your kid, that's not coming to all them your kids, praise God. God will give you your stuff back. If you know what I'm talking about, shout and holler in here, praise God. You just got to do it the way he wants it done. And then power comes, authority comes, the home is secure. I know we've been messed up, but I know the cops are corrupt in certain districts and everything, and man, it's appalling what's happening. You understand? It rubs me raw to see some white cop kill a black guy when he doesn't have to do it. Just pure racism. Say amen, somebody. But then on the other side, say amen, Simon. On the other side, somebody need to talk about why blacks keep killing blacks. And the only reason they keep killing each other because their identity is off. Because, come on, racist white supremacy have taught you that you're worthless and you look at your brother as worthless. You didn't make life. You have no business taking life. Come on, in gangs running around. Come on, I stole a 9mm. Trying to get a name for themselves and want to come up to my turf. Ain't got no D's down at the courthouse. Don't own nothing. Say amen. So I ain't even got an apartment. It's sleeping up, laying up somewhere. Stay up all night. Y'all don't want to talk here and then go sleep at the girlfriend house. Then walk around with graffiti on them. Talking about a gang. Ain't got nothing, praise God. Didn't even graduate high school. Come on. And then as soon as somebody piss you off. If you didn't catch it, I'll say it again. I said, as soon as somebody piss you off. You so dumb, you want to kill them. Ignorance. My people perish because of a lack of knowledge. Hallelujah. The church is the one that's got power. And we see a lot of times, so we ain't going to be like that. My name ain't Jamal Bryant. I'm not a performer. I ain't up here to perform. I'm about getting you right, praise God. I'm not Jamal Bryant, and I'll tell you about yourself, man. Say amen, somebody. Come on, I don't make babies in the church. Let's talk. Somebody say, now that's the church right there. That's the church, praise God. Glory to God. The church has power. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And when they come together as an orchestra and begin to pray, come on, the devil gets nervous. Hey! He'll let you sing. He'll let you do all kind of stuff. But when you start talking about praying together, he know he's in trouble, praise God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. I got to teach you who you are, man. Hallelujah. If I call for a prayer meeting on tomorrow night, you need to come to church, praise God. And be ready to pray. Come on, take some Visine, put some Visine in your eyes and drink a Red Bull and drink some coffee and be ready to pray because you are the church. This ain't no social club. Say amen, somebody. Now we cut back on social activity and have prayer meetings. I'm preaching, Ben, you're responding. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. The devil trying to kill our kids. We ain't got time to be relaxing out here. Say amen, somebody. Hallelujah. Come on, your kids are in the military. Both of them in the military. Come on, except for your oldest daughter. Come on now. Come on, we need to be praying. Thank you, Jesus. That boy don't in the army. He's over there fighting for our cause. And take a bullet from the enemy. You got that kind of power. All of our sons and daughters are coming back home safe. Isaac is coming back home safe. In the battle, but don't even smell like smoke. Y'all talk. Glory to God. I say you're the church. Glory to God. I feel all kind of virtue going out. I mean, anybody receiving this word, praise God. You're the church, praise God. You have the authority. Now Ezekiel. Ezekiel 28. Verse 14 says, thou art the anointed cherub that covereth, and I have set thee. So, this is speaking of the devil. Thou was upon the holy mountain of God. Look at his position. Thou hast walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire. Thou was perfect in thy ways. Can you imagine a perfect being? Can you imagine a perfect man? Are you here? This cat was perfect in all of his ways. Hallelujah. From the day that thou wast created till iniquity was found in thee. Are y'all there? It said, by the multitude of thy merchandise, they have filled the midst of the earth with violence. Now, this is the devil and has sinned. Therefore will I cast thee as profane out of the mountain of God. And I will destroy thee, O covering cherub, from the midst of the stones of fire. Thine heart was lifted up because of thy beauty. Are you there? Okay. Now here's the deal. See, we're going after, when we start talking about taking authority, we're going after the enemy, going into the enemy camp. What we're targeting is these are the devil's M.O.s. Y'all ready? Pride. Number one is the devil's M.O. All right? He lifted up himself. Are you? Okay. Okay. He was so perfect and beautiful. All right? He began to look at himself and got prideful. And God kicked him out of heaven. Are you here? It's the same thing that he tries to insert in you and me. Is a spirit of pride. And cause us to lift ourselves up. Because he knows if he can get you to lift yourself up, that's the quickest way for him to cast you down. Are y'all here? Did you hear what I say? If you start looking at yourself and start thinking about what you do, what you have accomplished, what you have obtained. See, Paul said, this one thing I do, I forget those things that are behind. Most of the time what we do, we think about sin. You know, some form of sin that we used to do. But if you read the chapter of Philippians chapter 3 in context, what you'll find out is he talks about his pedigree, he talks about his accomplishment, he talks about who he is as a Jew, tribe of Benjamin and all that. That's what he's talking about leaving behind. Look at my amen. I'm teaching you now. Forget those things that are behind. You're talking about adultery and fornication. That ain't what he was really talking about. In context, that's all well and good. You know, we can use some of that too. But what he was actually talking about was what his pedigree, the thing that he had accomplished, he counted it as dumb. Can I get an amen in here? Don't you go to sleep now. Wake up. I'm about to burst something in here. You hear what I say? Hallelujah. He said, that's what I'm counting. Come on. Okay, if I accomplished something yesterday, I'm forgetting it today because I got another journey I got to take today. I ain't going to be stuck back on what I accomplished yesterday when I got a whole life to live ahead. I pass. Every day of my life, I'm pressing toward the mark of it. Come on, that was good last week. That was good last year. But there's a goal I'm trying to reach. God, I feel God up in here. Glory to God. Hallelujah. That's what the enemy gets you at. You sit back looking at yourself, your beauty, and what you have done. You're getting ready to fall. Pride goes before a fall. A haughty look before destruction. I'll tell you something, okay? Okay, Pastor David, let's say you preached a good message Sunday. Then somebody come back Monday and say, Pastor David, you did a good job on Sunday. All right? I'm going to tell you what you need to do. Say thank you. And throw it in the trash can. Look. Look how y'all looking, man. Okay, may I leave Pastor Davis alone? Let me get something else. Y'all can't relate. Okay, they say you did good yesterday. All right, say thank you kindly and forget it. Throw it in the trash can and forget those things that are behind and press. Okay, here's the deal. Because the real deal is that don't nobody know you but God. You hear what I say? I said, don't nobody know you but God. Come on. Come on. And all only thing people see is just 10% of you. 90% of your thoughts only God knows. I ain't getting no help up in here right now. Oh, Pastor, leave us alone. No, I'm right up in the camp. You hear what I'm saying? You better cast down the imagination and move on and say, God, if you don't help me Monday, if you don't help me Tuesday, if you don't help me Wednesday, without you, I am nothing. Throw it in the trash can. I appreciate you when you come and say, Pastor, that was on point. I need encouragement like that, but praise God, tomorrow is coming. The enemy don't like it because I preached a good message. He gonna come and try to sidetrack me and do everything. I got to forget that stuff and press on into the next. Come on, there's another battle I got to fight. I ain't relaxing, praise God. I'm going to win every battle, praise God. You want me to get me think about my head and blow my head up, but I ain't crazy out here if it had not been for the Lord who was on my side. Now may Israel say, God is the one that was on my side. God is the one that preached the message. I give him the glory. I give him the honor. I give him the praise. And then I go right on back home like I'm a man. Not a pastor, a man. Humus, human being. Can I get an amen up in here? Glory to God. Yawning, hungry, got to bathe. Ain't nothing without God. I feel God up in here. Not a thing without God. So I forget those things that are behind, and I press every day of my life. I press toward the mark of the high calling. Ain't nothing too hard for me to do if God want me to do it. Glory to God. Glory to God. I forget my accomplishment. I forget my degree. I forget this. I forget that. I forget all that stuff. And I say, God, it's another day that the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So, see, here's the other deal. Here's the other deal. And what I'm going to do, Deacon Scott, is I'm going to stay on the carpet. Do y'all hear me right now? I say I'm going to stay on the carpet. Do you hear what I say? I say I'm going to keep my head on the carpet. You hear me when I tell you. Brother Frank, if I'm down on the carpet, ain't nowhere to fall. Hallelujah. As long as you lift it up in pride and self, you got a tendency to fall. Satan lifted up himself and God said, you're getting out of here. Is anybody getting this message here today? Everybody say, we're going to get this thing right, praise God. We're going to get it right. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Look at Luke 18. Hurry up. That's where he messed up and he want to get you right there. Verse 9 says, spake this parable to certain which trusted in themselves that they were righteous and despised others. Wow. Two men went into the temple to pray, the one a Pharisee, the other publican. The Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself, God, I thank thee. Look at this pride. I thank thee, talking to God, y'all. I thank thee that I'm not as other men are. Is anybody here? Thank you, Jesus. Extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even as this publican. See, you don't be praying like that. If anything, you'll be praying, God, I thank you for bringing me out of everything you brought me out of, because I used to be one of these right here. And look at him boasting in his righteousness here. He said, I fast twice in the week. I give tithe of all that I possess. Look at his pride. And the biggest blessing you're going to get is when you give in secret. Not when some false prophet come and have a money line, $10, $20, $100, $500, $1,000 line, and then you come up in front of the church because you got more money than everybody else. And you jump in the $1,000 line when you ain't got it because you're prideful. You're writing a credit card check because you want to get up in church and act like you something. Say amen, somebody. Hallelujah. Glory to God. How did I tell you about you? Come on, praise God. They ought to have a $1 line. And if a person only has a dollar and put $1 in there, they gave more than the fool up there writing a credit card check for $1,000 trying to look good in front of folk. That's the Bible. Jesus said he came and he watched how they give. Come on here. Come on, what they gave. You understand? Hallelujah. And that widow came in with a mic. Well, there's two mics. Two mics. You understand? Hallelujah. And, you know, folk come in like this is my check. Let me tell you something, man. If you make $1 million a year, what's your tithe for $1 million? How much? Okay, $100,000. Okay, so you pray $100,000 in tithe, and I make $50,000 a year. What's my tithe? $5,000. Come on. You pay $100,000 in tithe, and I pay $5,000 in tithe. You have not given more than me. Where my help at in here? He says, I'm going to give you a scale to go by. If they ain't got much money, tell them to bring a turtle dove. It's what's on their level. And I'm going to count it like they brought a bullet. Come on, if they moving on up a little bit, let them bring a ram. Let them bring a sheep. But if they ain't got it, praise God, let them give what they got. And if you can bring a turtle dove, and that's all you got, you gave just as much as that priest that came with a bullet. Somebody help me say, pride will get you in trouble, praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. He's all puffed up in pride. And the publican, look at this now, standing afar off, would not so much lift his eyes up unto heaven, but smote upon his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I ain't nothing, Jesus. I need help out here. And Jesus said, I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone that exalts himself shall be abased, but he that humbles himself shall be exalted. This is a principle. This is a law. If you humble yourself, God will raise you up. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. I say he'll raise you up. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And, you know, the funny thing about it is people, you know, sometimes you can be prideful. Let's put it like this right here. You can be prideful by making a 50 on the test. Are you there? Our scale is what, 100? You make 100 marks, you're all right, okay? Okay, you're doing good. You're 90, you're in the 90 percentile, you're A. A minus up to 100, A plus, right? All right? But you can be prideful making a 50. Are you here? You say, well, Pastor Warman, how can I be prideful making a 50? 50 ain't even passing. You can be prideful making a 50 if your 50 was the highest score in the class. Say amen, somebody. And that's the way some of us are. We're prideful. We made a 50 and we're proud because we made a 50 because everybody else made lower than us. But if I take your 50 and put you in advanced classes and you get in there with folk making 4.0 every day, you're going to look pretty silly. Hey, hit your name and say, keep your face on the carpet, man. If you make an A, B, C, D, or F, keep your face on the carpet. You hear me, Pastor Douglas? Hallelujah. Keep your face on the rug. Then we don't have to worry about you falling. Then we know your company, Scott, is going to just keep thriving and going higher because they know where to fall. Are y'all here? Everybody say, pride is the devil's MO, praise God. Okay, I'm rushing through this here, but the next point I want you to write down, I'm going to let you go, is that the other MO of the devil, this is very important, is discontentment. Are you there? I want everybody to say that with me, discontentment. Okay. Pull up 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 6. Yeah, praise God. Amen. But godliness with contentment is what?
Great gain.
Okay, so I'm pressing after this name, Deacon Jones, to where I don't want to have nothing in me, zilch, zero, anything that the devil can mess with. And by the same token, I'm content with where I am. All right, godliness with contentment is great gain. Are you there? That's what the devil did. See, what I say, pride, okay, and discontentment. Okay, let's go back to the garden again. Adam and Eve are in the garden. Look at this now. Look at this here. Okay, Pastor Davis, this is a commandment. Of all the trees in the garden, thou mayest eat thereof. But there's one in the midst of the garden, of the tree of the knowledge of good, thou shalt not. For the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. The devil comes in the garden with discontentment. Y'all ain't paying attention. You got every other kind of tree bearing good fruit, beautiful trees in the garden, and the enemy plants in your head, yeah, but you ain't got that one. And you get discontented with all your fruitfulness, all your bountifulness. You get discontented with that, and now you're going after one that God told you not to go. Okay, and you already know, Pastor Womack, I'm saying, praise God, you know, be in love with your own wife. Amen. And nobody else's. Amen. The enemy come in the garden and get you down. Well, you know, she didn't do this here right. You know, she didn't do that right. And bless God, yes, you. Are you here? Discontentment is what he plants. He plants it in there and get people discontented, and then before you know it, you're out of kilter, you're out of disorder, everything is chaos. I got a song ringing in my head. Y'all want to hear it? Diamond in the back, sun rooftop, digging the scene on a gangster lean. Ooh. You may not have
a great big Cadillac, diamond in the back, sun rooftop, digging the scene. Oh, you may not have a car at all, but just remember, brothers and sisters, that you can still stand tall. Just be thankful for what you got. Diamond in the back, sun rooftop, digging the scene on a gangster lean. Ooh, diamond in the back, sun rooftop. If you got a Humpty, go down there to AutoZone. Ain't enough chrome on there, buy you some chrome. Nail it on. And be thankful for what you got. Do you hear what I'm telling you today? There's power in thanksgiving. Philip, they come up to Jesus one day and say, hey, man, look, we got all these people out here. They hungry, man. They don't follow you up into this mountain. Ain't nobody got no food. He says, go get the boy. He said, the only little boy got a lunch, 2 fish, 5 loaves of bread. He said, go get it. When they went, got the 2 fish, 5 loaves of bread. And the Bible said, Jesus didn't get up there and start talking about Father God. Father God. Father God this, Father God there. Father, he did not get up there. The Bible says he took the bread, God have mercy, and gave thanks. Y'all not listening to me. Took what he had and gave thanks. And he said, now go give it to the people. And it just started. Be anxious for nothing. But in everything with prayer and supplication, let your request be made known to God with thanksgiving. And the peace of God will keep you. See, peace, thanksgiving. It's going to keep my heart. And God got that thing ready. He's going to make it. My bread going to multiply and my fish going to multiply because I'm thankful for what I got. I'm thankful for my neck bone. I'm thankful for my salmon patties and biscuits and I'm thankful for my souse meat and crackers. I'm thankful for my pork and beans and wieners. I'm thankful for my collard greens and cornbread. And come on, I'm thankful for what I got. The eyes of the Lord walking to and fro throughout the whole earth, seeking those whose heart is perfect. God is looking for somebody that's thankful for where they at right now. If you don't get nothing else, I'm going to tell you what I find out. I found out when I get contented, that's when God blesses me. As long as you yearning, you never get it. That woman make her sing another song, man. Yearning, learning is what you do. Stop, look what's behind you. Fame ain't ever going to find you. We just here to remind you, yearning, learning is what you do. So God said, say they won't listen to me. Let me get Philip Bailey and come on here and Maurice White. Thank you. Deacon McFadden, what you know about Maurice White? Let me get Earth, Wind, and Fire to preach to you since you won't listen to me. And they come out and they say, that's the way of the world. Plant your flowers. And it grows. You see, You see, all of these are principles. When you get contented, then God says, now when you get satisfied with where you are, and what he's trying to do is get us saturated with contentment, because he knows if you can get saturated with what you got, your next level ain't going to blow your head up. Did you hear what I said? He knows if you can be satisfied with what you got, Maypop tires, all right? And then he knows he can trust you with Michelin. You see what I'm saying? All right? A lot of us, we're just going from win after win, running after stuff, and don't ever catch up with anything because we never get contentment. Okay, Philippians chapter 4, verse 15. Now, ye Philippians, know also that in the beginning of the gospel, when I departed from Macedonia, no church communicated with me as concerning giving and receiving, but ye only. Next verse. For even Thessalonica ye sent once and again unto my necessities. Next verse. Not because I desire a gift, but I desire fruit that it may abound to your account. Wow. Next verse. But I have all and abound. I am full and having received of Epaphroditus the things which are sent from me, and an odor of a sweet smell. You're giving, you see? Sacrifice, acceptable, well-pleasing to God. Next verse. Okay. And my God, look at this, shall supply your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Okay, now go up to verse 7, I believe. 8, 9. Next. Okay, he says, not that I speak in respect of want. Are you there? I'm trying to give you the context of where you got to. You, my God shall supply all your needs. Okay, not that I speak in respect of want, for I have learned in whatsoever state I am, therewith to be what, somebody? Now notice what Paul says, next verse. I know both how to be abased, I know how to abound everywhere, and in all things I am instructed both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. It don't make no difference. God have mercy. Lord have mercy. I hope y'all tapping in right now. It don't make any difference. Whatever state I'm in, I learn how to be content. Okay? Okay? Okay, see, preacher, this is the thing. See, if God gonna use you, Minister Timothy, it's gonna be some stretching going on in your life. You can't be waiting to preach your message or to teach a class or to do whatever it is God got designed for you to do. You can't be waiting till you feel good. I hope you're catching this right here. I'm preaching to everybody right now. You can't be waiting till you feel good about it. No matter what's going on in your life, you are still a vessel of God, meet for the master's use. All hell can break loose, but that don't stop God from using. You understand? Okay. Unless I said, I don't feel good. Maybe I shouldn't teach tonight. I better call Pastor. No, you're not feeling good. Maybe the fact that you need to press through the mess that's got you feeling the way you feel, and God is squeezing you to bring that word out of your belly. Contentment. Content with where God has me. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. The older I get, the more contented I become. Amen. Thank you. Sometimes I go out of the house in the evening. I go check the mail. You know, I'm barefooted. All right. I'm purposely barefooted because I want to walk through my lawn that God gave me and feel the grass coming up between my toes and tell him thank you one more time. In my neighborhood, there are a whole lot of houses in my neighborhood bigger than my house. I don't want one. I like the house we in. Are you here? Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Glory to God. This is his MO. Pride, to get you puffed up in pride, and to get you discontented. If you can master it and keep him out of your business, keep him out of your garden. Everybody in here, I've gave marriage counseling to. You already know this here, but Adam and Eve had it going on until what happened? An intruder. An intruder came into the garden, and that's what he comes into the garden with. Pride, discontentment. Amen. Be thankful for what you got. Come on, we're standing. We're standing. I hope you can see my design, and I'm trying to steer this thing up so when we start to pray, we're going to be right on point. Amen? We're going to be right on point. We're going to go right and take what the enemy has stolen. Amen? Yesterday, my wife and the kids, they were out, and I was in the house by myself. They left the television on before they left, and I come through, and the learning channel was on. And it was talking about jail, females in jail. And God said, I want you to sit down and watch this here. Very seldom do I watch a whole television program. You understand? It's just not my thing no more. You know? I sit down and watch the thing. And God says, now you see what you just finished reading in your study? I said, yes, sir. He said, I'm going to show you something. The women that were incarcerated, two of them, one white and one black, both of them were in jail because they were lonely and wanted a man. Discontented. One of them read an ad in the newspaper about a hunk, you know, male escort. And she called it, and the guy come out. This is the black lady. The guy come out, and long story short, they make a relationship. And end up, this guy's a drug dealer. All right? And he's a wife abuser, wife beater and everything. Just low down guy. And turn, you know, you don't ever know who folk are. Okay, so she gets him in the house, and she's working and paying all the bills and everything. And all this evil is coming out of this guy. And eventually they get into a fight one day, and she claims he has a knife, and she has a knife, and she ends up stabbing him to death. All could have been avoided if she were never discontented. You wait till God send you somebody. And the white girl, she was talking about a guy, she was talking about how cute he was. You hear me? Hear me? She's talking about how cute the guy was and got infatuated with the guy. And the guy come home one day and said, I got something I need to tell you. She said, what? And he said, I did heroin. She's like, what? She said, I did it. You know, she was so infatuated with the guy that he said, now, do you want to do it? She gets hooked on the dope. Come over here. And then they become Bunny and Clyde. And she's doing 30 years in jail, all because she was lonely. Most of the women, God said to me, he said, most of the women are in jail not because they are criminals per se. They are in jail because they were lonely and wanted a man and reached out and got the wrong man. I say, I hear you, Lord. I hear you. I'm telling you women in here, you single women in here, if you ain't, come on, if he ain't saved, if he ain't bona fide saved, full of the Holy Ghost, Bible toting, you don't need the hell that a man can take you through. Amen. How am I doing today, y'all? And I thought about your ministry at Pulaski State Prison. I would venture to say 75% of those folks down there in that state prison is there because they needed a man. And he had them out pushing dope, selling a body, or doing whatever. Some old wicked man got them in jail. Okay, before you clap again, brothers. Come on here. Come on here. You come on. You be careful what you look at and what you desire. Because the Bible says a whorish woman, a harlot, is like a deep ditch. In other words, you can get in the ditch, but it's going to be hard for you to get out. It also says that the woman that decks her bed for a stranger to tempt him to come in to lie with her, and he comes in to lie, and she's married, and he don't see the fact he's enjoying the sex. And the Bible says, until a spear pierces him through his liver. I like the Bible. God said, look here, Solomon, when you write it down, tell them it's coming through their liver. The dagger is coming through the liver. That means you dead. You understand? Hallelujah. See, I love my Bible. I'm going to stick with my Bible. I'm going to stick with whatever. If I ain't got it, maybe I don't need it. I told you something Pastor Bank told me one time. He said, I don't want nothing that God ain't given to me. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hey, you catch hell, man. Easy getting stuff. 5 years of trouble just because you hot. 30 years of prison because you lonely. Here's the good news. The good news is, no matter what state you're in, Jesus shed his blood for you. And if you're here today, you can become a part of that church, to where the gates of hell shall not prevail against you. If you're here, you want to be a part of it, you just come. Don't think about it, just come by faith. This is it. Hey, look here. I ain't talking about shaking the preacher hand. Preacher ain't got nothing for you. I'm talking about giving your heart to God. Come on. Ain't nobody opening the doors of the church. The doors of the church have been open over 2,000 years. Whosoever will, let him come. If you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. If you hear, come. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I heard something ringing in my spirit yesterday. I was leaving the church, last night I think it was, and I heard it ringing in my spirit. It said, in that day, many will come and say, did not we do this in your name? He said, depart from me, ye that work. Scary. Ye that work iniquity, I never knew you. Wait a minute. You were in church. These people were doing, they were churching, casting out devils, performing miracles in the name of Jesus. And he's saying, depart from me, and I never knew you. And the reason I thought about that, because I was listening to a song, Sensational Nightingale. Oh, look at the people. I know this way past some of y'all right here. Oh, look at the people. Oh, look at the people. What are they doing, y'all? Standing up to judge again. Got to be tried. Standing up to judge again. Got to be tried. All of us gonna stand one day. Whether it's the white throne judgment, or it's the judgment seat of Christ, you're going to give an account to the deeds done in the body. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But when I stand before my judge, I want to hear him say, well done. May the work I've done speak for me. Hallelujah. 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 Ain't no quit, ain't no giving up in me. I'm going to run this race, and I'm going to run it with patience. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of my faith. If you feel like you want to get prideful, just look at Jesus. He'll keep you on the floor. Thank you, Jesus. You hear God's telling you this is where you need to be. You need a church. Everybody need a church home, man. Everybody need a church home. You need a safe haven. You need a place of prayer. You need a house of prayer. You need a family of prayer. If you hear God is leading you to be a part of this church, just come. Father, we thank you for how you're wooing us into prayer, and we thank you for the dominion that you've given to us, and I thank you for your saints as they begin to gear themselves up for fasting and prayer as we go into a new chapter of authority. I pray that everybody would get excited about it, and God begin to make lists about what they want you to do in these next couple of weeks. And God, and when we come together to pray, I pray, God, that you will release your blessings upon this congregation. Father, cause us to be giants in the spirit. Cause us to be strong. Cause us to be walls to be reckoned with. Bless these families. Bless them. Let them grow. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's bless God in our giving.
Hallelujah. 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 Everyone that can stand, stand, please. Hallelujah. Reverencing God. Amen. Father God, we just thank you now, Father God, for that rhema word, Lord God. I just pray to give us a receiving heart, Father God, whether it's here and here. Lord, bless this tithe, that it be used for the upbuilding of your kingdom, here and abroad. In Jesus' name, amen. Father, direct your ushers, please.
Press. When it don't feel good, let me see ya. When it gets a little tight, let me see ya. Until it gets right, let me see ya. Everybody!